Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. Let rain.
Morning, race fans, and welcome to Today at the Races at Laurel Park on this day after Christmas Day, Boxing Day, to our friends around the world. I'm Tim Telegram, joined by Keith Fussell. Keith, how you doing? How'd you pull up?
I'm doing well, doing well. We had a good little holiday break. Great to see the family and stuff. So couldn't see a lot of the younger ones, you know, the nieces and nephews, unfortunately. But we pulled some things together and had a very good time. How about yourself?
Great time. Limited, like you said, yep. But lots of fun. And my girls had a great Christmas, as they usually do. Keith, we've got a big day this afternoon. We've got a big show right here. It's our Christmas Tide Stakes Day. $850,000 worth of stakes, 8 stakes, and we get started in race one with the first one. We've got a nice carryover in the Rainbow Pick 6. That is up to $9,551. That gets started in race four, and I will have a ticket for that. Also, we have 3 more days of racing left here for the fall meet, but don't worry about it. Come January, we are going to be racing Friday through Sunday, January and February, 1225 posts, a couple holiday exceptions, but we'll make sure everybody knows about that. Keith, what's going on outside? What's our main track like?
I tell you, it should be tight and fast. I mean, it got chilly here this morning, didn't it?
It was.
I went out. It was about 22 degrees up in beautiful Reisterstown this morning, up to 29 right now. So, chilly. I think the track's going to play a little quick today.
I think it's playing a little quick. Mm-hmm. I was out on it this morning, and it was kind of that loose, winter loose type of track. So we'll have to see how the rest of it goes. But a big card this afternoon, and we get it started in race one, the $100,000 heft for 2-year-olds. It also kicks off the early pick 5. Naomi Tucker has a ticket. Let's take a quick look at Naomi's ticket this afternoon, $40.50 play. She goes 3 deep in the half using the 4, 5, and 6. Her signal comes in the Gin Talking, and why not? Oh, the 5 Street Loot was in very, very good form. 1, 7, 8 in the Anne Arundel County Stakes, $100,000 going 1/16. 4, 5, 6 in race 4, the Howard County, and then 1, 5, 9 in race 5, the Willa on the Move. $40.50 ticket. Good luck if you play along in the early pick 5 with that low, industry low takeout, and always a fun bet, mandatory payout. Race 1, the half stakes, 2-year-olds, $100,000 going 7/8 of a mile. And we're going to kick it off with a video of the 4, No Sense. You have No Sense on top. I have them in my trifecta, but here we go. It's the last start.
Yeah, I tell you, No Sense, a winner of 3 straight, a very tactical runner, improving, overcame a little bit of a slow start last time as well. You got to like that in the James F. Lewis Stakes. Beat a quality field, and that number really jumped up from a buyer of 69 to 81. But No Sense, you're going to see this horse just – you know, rate so kindly mid-turn after that little slower beginning, got up to contention without much effort, going to find the seam here, works outside top of the stretch, responds and goes clear. I tell you, No Sense, Cal Lynch with these 2-year-olds year in and year out, he's just been deadly. He's done fine in some of the stakes competition, maybe not quite as high as maybe the allowance or the maidens, but I tell you, this horse looks like he's moving. And look at the stride, really, really reaching, Tim, the last 1/8 of a mile. No Sense right back. We've got a change of rider. We're going to have some rider changes today, so I'm sure you and Naomi
Alex Cintron on No Sense.
Yeah, keep the fans abreast.
Yeah, I mean, good-looking win. A little concerned where he was wanting to bear in at the top of the stretch a little bit, maybe a little green, wanting to lay on that horse, but then straighten out and went upon his business. And a big number, but I think that's a legitimate number. He ran. It was a nice pace in front of him. He ran into it and finished up well. That 81 buyer speed figure. The 5 is Boss Logic. That's who I have on top in your exacta. This one's stepping out of a claiming $25,000 winner's race this afternoon, but fired a lifetime best. First off the claim for Dale Capp going 7/8.
Yeah, barn change there. And I tell you, Boss Logic was very eager to the wire. Showed improved speed. Looked kind of like a one-run sprinter with prior connections. No. Improved speed. Maybe not quite as fast as Singolino that opening quarter, but Boss Logic, I think, will be able to stalk and move on with it. Dale, 36%, 4/11, second off the claim following a win the last couple years. Yeah, this was a huge improvement in the new barn. I think this horse will hold pat.
And this isn't a Dale move. He must like this horse to take this step into state company this afternoon. To his outside is Singolino, coming off a pretty good effort behind a very good Jackson Traveler in his last start. And we'll pick that video up at the 316th pole.
Yeah, let's watch this one. I tell you, did all of the dirty work. You know, Jackson Traveler was able to shake clear early. Looked like he was going to be long gone, maybe, Tim, around the turn. Singolino says, I'm going to try to battle back and get you. Just couldn't quite run him down this particular. He's a big horse, Singolino.
Yes.
He's another one just kind of can grind you into the ground. I think he's going to have to be forward. I mean, right in here, a good clean break, shorter field from the outside. Maybe he just tries to take the initiative. He's going to be a tough cookie if he clears.
He will be tough. He is no problem staying close to the pace. Mm-hmm. They went 22-2. 45-3 in that last race behind Jackson Traveler. 4/5 for Keith in the opener, 5/6 for myself. As we move to race two, the second of our 8 stakes this afternoon, the Gin Talking, $100,000, 4 2-year-old fillies. It kicks off the early pick 4. And Keith, you have a ticket.
Yeah, a little ticket, $30 here. Unfortunately, in this race, a couple scratches out of race 2. Actually, 3 of them, the 2, the 4, and the 7. That's going to leave me with the 5 and the 6, that you're two favorites here. Street Luke going to be your favorite, a short price in race 2. Race 3, 1 and the 7, Guns Blazing, a price shot for me. I saw Naomi use this filly as well. I think this horse might make a big jump here going out to the 2 turns for Trombetta. The 7, Miss Leslie, second off the claim. Race 4, I think the Howard County Stakes is wide open. You see that 1, 3, 4, 5, 6. We'll wrap it up with this early pick 4 with 3 horses, the 1, the 5, and the 9 in the Willa on the Move Stakes. There's your ticket, $30 to get you started.
I agree with that because I went 4 deep in race 4, the Howard County. As I mentioned, race 2, the Gin Talking, $100,000. 4 2-year-old fillies going 7/8 of a mile. Take out the 2, take out the 4, make the rider on the 6, Javion Toledo. Mm-hmm. Javion Toledo rides the 6 out of sorts, and also take out the 8, the outside horse, Blissful Behavior, the 7. Well, you can't start this race without starting with Street Loot, who's a neck shy of being undefeated. Her last race here on December 5th in the Maryland Juvenile. We'll pick this one up at the 3/8 pole that particular afternoon. What an effort this was.
Yeah, and she's showing the versatility here. She can go to the front. She can sit just off of it. And I tell you, Xavier Perez puts her in a beautiful position, kind of like the ride No Sense Scott, right? So he's just going to be very patient to the inside, works through that opening top of the stretch, and Street Loot really responds. Is going to open up a clear advantage here past the 3/16 and hold firm to the wire. She's a really nice filly, I tell you. You know, I looked at what they paid for, 10-5, and I looked at the mare. The mare was on race. You could go a little deeper. There wasn't a ton there. This must have been a really good-looking filly. For a yearling, you think 10-5 is not too much. But all things considered, just a first blush. So, I mean, and she has lived up to what they thought, and she's running great. I think she's going to be awfully tough right back here for Jerry Robb and company.
I think so, and she's been very, very good. As I mentioned, only a neck shy of being undefeated. Naomi Tucker was able to catch up with Xavier Perez to talk about Street Loop.
Yeah, she's an easy-going filly to ride. It's pretty similar to Honest Bandit. That's why I think I get to bond into her too so quick, because she's a straightforward filly, and she do whatever I ask her to do. And she can go to the lead, and she will. She will settle. She stalk, and she's not afraid of anything. Like, she showed the first time I rode it, she went through the rail. And the second time that I rode it, she just split horses and just showed bravery all the time. I'm really excited. I can't wait to come back from the little vacation that we're going to have for Christmas. And I think it's going to be a beautiful Christmas present for me.
She certainly is a nice filly and brave. She is mm-hmm. brave. She doesn't care in behind horses, between horses. Yeah. She does whatever you ask. The six out of sorts. Brittany Russell trains Make the Rider, Javion Toledo. Brittany and Claudio Gonzalez still a deadlocked at 22 wins with mm-hmm. three racing days left this year in our fall meet. But Out of Sorts coming out of that street loot race on November 20th. A few works since, mm-hmm. but her best race has been on the off going on the slot.
It was. But she had a little excuse down towards the inside in her last, coming away a little slowly. I thought the finish up was well, hoping a little bit more of the speed would stay in this race. I think the connection certainly wish maybe the four Beautiful Grace would have stayed in to maybe supply some good flow here. Whiskey and Rye is a horse that overcame trouble, you know, major trouble last time out. I did not see that coming from and racing from off the pace. So, Maybe she goes to the front of here. But Street Loot, she's the one to beat. She's going to be an awfully short price. And X-Man took the words right out of my page, right off my page here. I said Anna's Bandit. And looking back, and I went and kind of compared, you know, the careers of the two. Obviously, Street Loot just getting started here. But Street Loot definitely a little bit faster at this point of the game. So, yeah, maybe she's going to move up and maybe even be a slightly better version. I don't know.
Right,
it's hard
know.
To say. Anna's
you
Bandit
can't
was,
get around
was incredible.
Making some comparisons yeah. with Anna's Bandit, with the connections and
yep.
how well she's running mm-hmm. the Gin Talking, the second of our eight stakes this afternoon. A race three. Well, we can just keep going here. The Anne Arundel
yes.
County, $100,000, a mile 16th for two-year-old fillies. And we're going to start with the seven. Super High Five gets
right.
underway here. Every race with seven or more runners. Super High Five available. No carryover from our last racing day. We're going to start with the seven. Miss Leslie. First time off the claim for Claudia Gonzalez in her last start. She mm-hmm. ran a lifetime best. She stretches out here this afternoon.
Yeah, in a race, you're looking at it. And there's no true speed, it looks like, at this mile and 16th distance. But Miss Leslie, she was pretty keen last time. I mean, just settled. I mean, she wasn't really fighting the rider all, but she moved up quite easily to the leaders around the 5/16th, went out wide and just really dusted them and was rolling through the gallop out. I mean, it looked like she was 20 in front, you know, going into that clubhouse turn. So looking at the distance, painters are fine going long. You know, 6/8, you know, 6 furlongs to a mile 60s. A little tricky sometimes, but I tell you, that was a big effort visually. I think within this group, she's going to have to be forwardly placed. I think she's going to show
yeah.
natural speed to be well placed. But take a look at the one. We have a video of the one,
yeah,
guns blazing.
Yeah, we do have the one. I've been going back to real quick to
okay.
Miss Leslie.
Yeah.
The only problem is she's going to have to overcome that draw. I mean,
yeah.
you draw outside there. She's going to have to do a little work early, but
mm-hmm.
I like her. The stretch out shouldn't be a big deal.
Yeah.
Yeah, the one, guns blazing, a filly that you use.
Yes.
That I don't,
mm-hmm.
but coming out of a big race in the last start.
Yeah, I just think, you know, looking at this, we're going to get Cintron today. No knock. I mean, Rebecca Albabar rode great this day. Perfect
a great ride. Perfect.
A little more experienced rider here this afternoon from this inside post. And yeah, the buyer figures aren't real glamorous, right? But
no.
we've seen horses make big jumps at this time of the year. I looked at one of the siblings, a horse by the name of, was it 13 Square? It might have been a Baffert runner, made a big jump kind of at a similar point. So why not for Guns Blazing? Look at this. Perfectly rated, eases out, and really just kind of under steady pressure is going to take command and go clear. The final time, 38-3. Pretty good for a two-year-old filly at a mile, and I think it was a sub-25 final quarter. I like that. Great position stretching out. I think she can make a jump here. Trombetta's got to think enough of her to put her in this spot.
Yeah, and she really stretches out that
mm-hmm.
last 16th of a mile. Really nice ride that afternoon by Rebecca
yep.
Labar, but draws the fence and laid close to sprinting.
Mm-hmm.
Does this one go right to the front? Because yeah, it's got to be in your mind.
Yes.
You get that inside
yes.
draw.
I think you're right. I think looking at her internals, they weren't terrible, all things considered. She may not be as quick as a Miss Leslie, maybe a Malibu Beauty or a Tarch. We'll see. But I think she's going to have enough. They're gonna ask her enough. You know, doesn't want to be shuffled back at all. So I think you got to send a little bit to get that early Poe.
The 8 Bucky's Charm interest to both of us for Hammy Smith coming off a good race in her last start going 7/8 of a mile.
Yeah, I mean, Bucky's charm. I like the progression, the way they're doing with the distances. Now 2.78 out to a mile and 1/16. Another one, though, looks a little bit like a closing sprinter. And, again, I think if anybody's going to be hampered by the post, it might be this one. I don't know if she's as naturally quick. We'll see, as Miss Leslie. But, yeah, the grass is blue. I've got it 9-5. Chad Brown with a runner coming down. I think Sedano is now on. Trevor off the mounts today. Yes. Sedano. So take that morning line with a little bit of grain of salt. I don't know if she's going to be that short. I know it's the Chad Brown factor, but I had the Brown factor. The McCarthy factor certainly was going to affect the odds and take her down. You might get a little bit better value with the grass is blue. No knock on Carroll. It's just going to happen from a odds standpoint. I think you're going to see these favorites a little tighter when it's all said and done.
But she was pretty well-regarded in that Keeneland race. Yeah. She was just under 3-1. The next out winner won that race. Uh-huh. She runs back to the Keeneland race from October 4th. While stretching out, and nothing says that she shouldn't be able to stretch out and see how it all goes for her. She's going to need to get away.
Yeah.
She's not gotten away well in two of her three lifetime starts.
She was a little quirky, Tim, down through the stretch of that race at Keeneland. She was kind of snaking around, lugging in, get her straight, laying in again. I don't know. I don't know if she's a one-run sprinter. Obviously, I liked her off the debut. Looked like a purchase there, but I don't know. With that shorter price, I'm going to go elsewhere with some prices in here. Miss Leslie, I tell you, she might end up the favorite.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me. Yeah. Wouldn't surprise me at all. Cut out to get a route of ground and won so easily the time before. A race of four kicks off the pick six, and we have a carryover of just over $9,000, $9,551. I have a nice ticket day, a nice affordable ticket, $38.40, and I go four deep, just like you went deep on your early pick four, Keith. I use the 1, the 2, the 4, and the 5. The 5, Shaq Queen King, is my top pick there. In a race 5, 3 deep there, the 1 of 5 and the 9. That's the Willow on the Move. Race 6, the Dave's a Friend. 4 deep here. This race, even with a couple scratches in there, this race is a tough race. 3, 5, 6, 8 there. My single comes in race 7. That's Harper's First Ride. In the Native Dancer, race 8, the grade 3, Allaire DuPont. I go 2 deep here. I use the 4, Air Ace 2, and the 5, Ice Princess for Danny Gargan, coming off a nice race, a pretty nice race, first off the layoff up there at Aqueduct. And then 3, 4 in the finale, $38.40 ticket. Good luck if you play along in the Rainbow Pick 6. Race 4, the Howard County, $100,000 for two-year-olds going a mile and a 16th. And we're going to get started with your top pick, Erewhon, for Jose Corrales. And when I first looked at your pick, I went, okay. And then I looked at it again and went, okay. Keith might be on to something here, so go ahead.
Yeah, I'm completely going to toss the race on a sloppy sealed surface up in New York. I thought that was a big reach. And, just wasn't involved at all. So I go back to the two-back race, and I went back and watched this race a little bit. A little trouble out of the gate, and a little pinch, and this horse got herself way back. A little slight trouble at the quarter pole, had to wait and rallied into it. We've got video, actually, of the Ain't the Beer Cold. So I think Erewhon, with a cleaner break, is going to stay a little bit closer, and this horse is going to bring a finish today for a barn that is absolutely red hot, 30% over the last 30 days at Laurel. So let's watch this. Ain't the Beer Cold, who I think is going to go to the front again.
Then you've got Market Cap, then you got Erewhon.
Market Cap in the pink colors, kind of just drifting it slightly there. But watch Ain't the Beer Cold dig in. He was taking pressure every step of the way. What a courageous effort this was.
Really was.
And then Erewhon is going to, on that left lead, fine room, finally between horses. I think it might switch over late. There you go. And really closes up to gain. Okay, there you go. Three horses, three quarters of a length, basically separates them. I think you're going to have another close finish today. But Erewhon, with a little bit better trip, might be able to get over the top, because I think there's going to be a convergence of a few of these horses, maybe top of the stretch, because Shaq Queen King, King is not going to let Ain't the Beer Cold get too far away as well.
I wouldn't think so. Mm-hmm. By Shackleford, I have a Lori Ron Mayer, the going the route of ground, already has done it pretty successfully. Ran behind Hello Hot Rod. We know how good Hello Hot Rod is, so that's my top pick there. You're on Erewhon. But that race is wide open. I mean, I think that's very, very wide open. Go as deep as you can on all your pick fours, pick fives, and Rainbow Pick 6. We've got to take a little bit of a break. When we come back, we'll talk about the Willow on the Move.
And they're off. 12 as they roll into the backstretch.
Late pick five time as we return to today at the races. No carryover from last Sunday, but 50 cent minimum, 12% takeout, industry low. Late pick five gets started in a race of five. And Keith, we're going to start with the one, Don't Let Sweet Fool You. You have Don't Let Sweet Fool You on top, and we're going to watch this video from the start.
It's a good spot to start, I'm telling you. Don't Let Sweet Fool You is able to kind of get command right off the bat here on this November 28th race, the Primonetti Stakes. I say, watch the speed. I mean, I think
speed.
This is key, natural speed.
Yeah,
so just dragging the rider right up to contention. I don't know if the plans were completely let's go ahead and get it, but she did it so easily. But that brings me to another point. She takes the pressure a little bit, repels the challenge, and draws off here by, what, 5 1/4 when it's all said and done with a 91 fig. There's a very fast horse in here. A couple quick ones. Never Enough Time, what we see in this race, is back in Malibu Mischief. But it's that move out of the gate that I'm not too concerned about the rail, Tim.
No.
I think if she just comes away cleanly, pretty cleanly, she's going to naturally get her position. She's going to bring a finish. Lacey's done a great job of tweaking maybe some equipment with her. We talked about that last time to get her running straight. A couple races back, she was kind of drifting, getting out. They look like they've got her figured out. She's running straight and true. I don't think she's a stone cold need to lead type. So I think her natural speed puts her in position. Maybe she can dog Malibu Mischief from the quarter pole home.
And we had a few minutes to catch up with Lacey Gaudette to talk about Don't Let Sweet Fool You.
She's doing great. She came out of the last stake very well. And I know that there's another stake in January, but she's done well coming back on a quick turnaround. So we decided while she's doing well right now, we'll run her right back. She's always been fast and she's always been in front. We do want to test her eventually, and we thought we were going to have to test that last time in the stake last time. She was on the outside. We were going to let the speed unfold on the inside and see if she could come back at him, and she just showed a different sort of speed that I don't even think we were prepared for. So she kind of showed that she can still hold that speed with a better class of horses. So I haven't really looked at the race entirely yet. I think that we're just going to kind of let her do her thing. Jevy and Toledo, he really fits her well, and I think he gives her a lot of confidence. So hopefully she breaks well and she's there, and I think that he's just going to let her tell him where she wants to be.
And Don't Let Sweet Fool You is looking for her fifth win in a row. We've got a couple of fillies in here that are on big win streaks, including the 5 Malibu Mischief. She's won 6 in a row. She's stepping up to stakes company today, but she's already a 2-time winner here at Laurel Park.
Yeah, how about this? Off the claim, just rolling right along. And now she's going to stretch out about, you know, off the 5 1/2, out to 6. She's quick. I think she's faced a little bit softer company, maybe not as quality. She took advantage of an off-the-turf race 2 races back where she got away slowly but really showed a great burst of speed. Never Enough Time's pretty quick as well. The way I see this, if they come away cleanly from the gate, I could see Don't Let Sweet Fool You just kind of drafting in behind the 2 speeds and getting that perfect kind of undercover trip, you know, use a harness term, and then go from there. But maybe a little price horse to use underneath is the 3 Shies. I know Club Car is going to take some money coming in from Kentucky. She's 0-for-6 at the distance, but she likes the distance. She's going to need things to develop, though, I think, up top.
She will, but she's in a good position on the outside there. She won't get in too much trouble. I agree with you. Don't Let Sweet Fool You. Her natural speed will, at worst, keep her in good position early in the race. That's the Willa on the move. And Keith has Don't Sweet Fool You. Don't Let Sweet Fool You on top. I've got the 5 Malibu Mischief on top. A race of 6 is the Dave's Friend. Couple scratches here. Take out the 1, Sambaye. Take out the 2, Share the Ride, who was my original top pick. And make the rider on the 3, Taco Supreme. Kevin Gomez, make the rider on the 6, where she told me to go, Javion Toledo, and that takes care of all the changes in race 6. $100,000 for 3-year-olds and up, going 3/4 mile. And even with those scratches, this is still a pretty tough race. You have the 3, Taco Supreme on top, coming off his best effort of this year.
Yeah, I took him a few races back in the Polynesian, and, you know, he just didn't fire. I don't know what happened that day. Drafted back off the pace, a little wide, and no kick. And maybe that mile race kind of threw him out of sorts. I'm not so sure. But Taco Supreme, he's a horse that's beaten Lakai in the past, and he's beaten this kind of a horse, and he's going to offer the best value of the three horses right here, because I think that most of the money's going to come go to the six where she told me to go. And Lakai, Taco Supreme, probably laying in there at your third choice. I'm going to go for a little bit better value. This is a tactical kind of runner. I think he can even just – I don't think the 95 doesn't scare me. I think he can come back to that race. He's done it in the past. He's going to get great position just off of the speed. Maybe now goes the charge to victory and this Charlestown ship and Penguin Power. But Taco Supreme, I think he's ready. Maybe turns the tables on a few of these horses now of recent note. He was against the bias two races back, was four wide against a good sprinter, was denied, but he was against the grain on October, was at the 30th. So, yeah, a little better value really here, Taco Supreme.
Yeah, really sharp work since then. December 20th, 47-3. We're going to check out a quick video right here that has Where She Told Me to Go and Lakai, and this was in the Frank Whiteley just on the 20th November.
Yeah, and I tell you, the winner here, Where She Told Me to Go, got a little better trip than Lakai. Lakai broke well, and then all of a sudden I look back, and he's, you know, he's 5, 6, 7 out of it. He drafted back off the pace and ends up getting fan wide, where She Told Me to Go, the 7 just settled in the clear, was able to work out in between horse. Watch Lakai kind of get fanned out, a little drift in Where She Told Me to Go. But they put on a great run here, don't they? The final eighth of a mile, you know, head-to-head, nose-to-nose. What a horse race, right, this one is. So there you go. I tell you, these two crack sprinters, can't take anything away from them, and they're going to be right back in it. I think they're going to be tactical in this field. We've got a really good horse race
this
right here in
the
day's run. I expect a blanket finish.
And look, Lakai, I mean, look at him. He was nose to the ground. It looks like a greyhound. He's digging it all the way down there. Where She Told Me to Go, coming off that big win on November 28th, a little bit of a layoff. And we were able to catch up with Brittany Russell earlier this week.
He's just a neat horse. He's he doesn't actually, as big as he is, he doesn't require as much training as you would think. He kind of does well. You just kind of keep the horse happy. And I've also learned that he's a warrior. He's just pure racehorse. So he likes to race and he's a fighter. So I think you walk him over in the afternoon and he's going to give you what he has. He's great. He's fantastic. He's moving well. He's you know, he hasn't missed a beat. So hopefully, you know, he ran a big number last time. So we're hoping there's always a chance of a bounce. But he's doing well enough for us to give him a shot on Saturday.
And Keith, this is a really good race. I just tried to do the math real quick during that video, and I think with the horses left in, they've won 48 races combined. These horses know how to run.
Yeah.
They know how to win. Lakai is just ultra consistent. He's a 10-time winner, and he's just a fun horse to watch. Won the Grade 3 to Francis Dash 2 starts back.
And I tell you, the guy, you know, I was be remiss. The outside horse is going to show some speed, no doubt. One more great time. When he's on his game, he's pretty quick. The blinkers go on. He's going to be out there trying to battle. And, he could carry it a while. Maybe he's just not quite – this, you know, but he's gonna force the issue. But it's tremendous. You look on the page, you see a 102 buyer, 108 buyer on some of these horses. I mean,
it's a nice race.
These guys are proven. They're really good, good sprinters.
It's a really, really nice race. Dave's friend this afternoon, race 7, the Native Dancer, $100,000 going a mile and an eighth. I love seeing these mile and eighth races. And we've been seeing a lot more of them. And we're going to kick off this with Harper's First Ride and Cordmaker coming out of the Richard Small on November 28th.
Yeah, and Cordmaker didn't have the greatest of trips.
No, he didn't.
You know, you see on there the two horse that day just waiting and waiting and waiting. He's like, whoa, whoa, he looks to the outside. Harper's First Ride, where are you going? You got the jump on me. That's not fair, right? So Harper's First Ride with the old loop and swoop four wide just kind of gets the advantage. But take Cordmaker, this guy, take nothing away from his effort. He's really, really running well. And Harper's First Ride, though, he just looks like he's just got the best of them every time they go, though, doesn't he? You know, he's going to have a hiccup, maybe encounter some traffic problems or something if Cordmaker's going to be able to kind of turn the tables. Cordmaker's been one of my favorite horses over the last couple of years here in Maryland, though. Love him. He's a really cool horse.
And, you know, he had a tough trip in that last start. You live by the rail, you can die by the rail, and that's exactly what happened.
Yep.
Harper's First Ride out there in clean air, taking the high line and just keeps on going. Momentum stays up. But, look, you know, Cordmaker is interesting because he certainly hasn't had the year that he had last year. But his last three races, they're going, he's starting to go in the right direction all of a sudden. That was a big race running behind Harper's First Ride, a couple works since that last race.
You take Harper's First Ride out of the equation, he might be close to that year. That's the problem. I think that's the biggest thing. He's running into this guy for Claudio, that's been the problem. So
but Harper's First Ride, he's run triple-digit buyers on two of his last three starts. Mm-hmm. And he just won that last race pretty much as easy as he wanted to do. Yeah. I mean, Cordmaker got into a little bit of trouble. The 3 Air Token, big 17-1 winner of the Concern, 2 starts back. Backed that up with a win against Softer in his last race. He's an interesting kind of horse. Jose Corrales has this one in very, very good form, looking for 4 in a row. And this is what Jose had to say about Air Token.
I'm just going day by day with this horse. I mean, this horse is showing me something, that whatever. I mean, I claim this horse for 10. I think if I can win for 16, I'm happy. Or I drop him back for 10. But he's showing me better. But, you know, it's like horses, like I always say, to me, it's like people. They need opportunity, and you never know how far you can go. And this horse have done that. Well, it's mean a lot. It helped me a little bit with my pocket. And, you know, it's like, it make you feel good, but like I say, it make me feel good for the horse. You know, sometimes it's like when Stronach hire me, I don't feel like, when he hired me, I say, how I got that lucky? You know what I mean? I feel lucky with the horse the same way.
Stretching to 9 furlongs this afternoon, Keith. And, Jose's Walt's doing all right. Yeah. He's having a great meet, winning at about 23%.
He's walking a little taller, right, with a little extra coin in his pocket, you know, shoving those hundreds everywhere in the shoes and the Miami Hotel. But good stuff. You got to love it. You got to love it. And opportunity's the name of the game.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, right.
You know, let's look at our leading trainer right now. You know, Brittany, what she's done with her opportunity, made the best of it. And you got to love that. And he's got – yeah, these trainers have ability. They get along with the horse. They know what to do, and you just need that little break in this game. And so many guys don't. You know, they're in it for a long time. They grind it out, but never get that real helping hand. And glad to see Corrales like that. And I'm not going to doubt anything he's got going right now. He's rolling right along.
He's rolling.
Air Token's got a shot. Saratoga Jack, I think, is going to be your speed, the 5. But Air Token will make a move into him. Let's see if he can kind of come back to that, that 90 fig. He could be into the mix.
He could be. Make the rider on Cordmaker Perez, the 1, make the rider on the 2 Hall Pass Cintron. Mm-hmm. And let's see, VIP ticket. Make the rider Javion Toledo in the Native Dancer. So some rider changes there in the Native Dancer. But interesting race. We'll see how it all shakes out for Cordmaker and Harper's First Ride and Air Token for that matter. Race 8, the Allaire DuPont Grade 3, a race that we typically run on Preakness Day. Transferred to the this afternoon, or Christmastide Stakes Day. And this shakes out to be a pretty interesting race. I keep looking at this race, and there could be a couple horses, but we're going to start with Air Ace 2 for Arnaldo Delacour and look at her last race in the 38 Go-Go from the 28th of November.
Yeah, and I tell you, a little patience looking paid off, right? Man, they give this horse a break, and did she respond? She's a big, good-looking filly. Yeah, you go down and check her out in the paddock, you know, or watch her come out on the track, but she just, you know, cruising speed, decent, finish, brings it, and it's going to be tough to deny her, I think, again this afternoon. Yeah, she's going to have to deal with landing zone. I think that's going to be her main threat up front. But what Delacour has done off of that break from March of 19 to October of 2020, the way she's come back now, 2 straight wins, you know, just solid fashion, holding firm here, never really in doubt from the 3-ace pole home. Airs 2 is going to be very difficult to beat, I think, in race number 8. The Allaire DuPont. Here's a stat for Delacour. Last 3 years, 12 for 45, 27% with dirt routes off of a top fig. ROI is a positive 1-2-21. Make Toledo the rider. Ice Princess is going to get Alex Cintron. And Ruiz goes on needs supervision.
Yes, and speaking of needs supervision, a horse that neither you or myself use has never really come back to the form from 2019, kind of hanging around. But we talked to Jeremiah O'Dwyer about this one earlier this week.
She's a good feeling filly. She always shows you that she's in great form at home. I mean, she trains good every morning. Breezy, she's a very good workhorse. She'll always, you know, show up in the mornings. You know, we give her a run back over 6 furlongs. She's a little outpaced early and then came home well. I'm glad to see her come home well because I was a little disappointed early in the race that she was so far off him. But at least she finished off her race. I'm confident, you know, would I prefer a mile or a mile and 16? Probably so, yeah. But, I mean, it's a grade 3. It'd be great for her stud value if we could get in the money in a race like that. Be great for the owners, you know, they're good supporters of mine. So look, we're taking a shot. Philly's been training good. She's a little quirky, you know, Sheldon knows her. She's one of those, you know, she just likes to get on with it. You know, if you're trying to rate her too much, she'll fight you. But if you can just work with her, she'll give you a great ride around her.
The $150,000 grade 3 Allaire DuPont could go to Landing Zone, Keith. Horse is a winner of 4 of her last 5. And as she stretches back out where she's done her best running.
Yeah, and I think it's going to be right to the front, I believe, for Landing Zone. I think she maybe wants to take it to Eras 2. If Eras 2 clears and relaxes, she should be gone. But these two, I think, you know, the mile and eighth distance, I think, you know, with their speed and stamina, they have a little edge. I think they can carry it quite a ways in here. I think they're going to be tough to beat on, you know, from the top. I think Eras 2 is maybe a little bit better, in my opinion, right now. But I think Landing Zone, take nothing away from her back out to the route. I think she's going to hang around a long ways.
A long way with another broad for Steve Asmussen. The 2, Johan Rosado rides there. I just take out Eras 2. I mean, this could work out to be a decent spot for her. I think it got a user somewhere.
Okay.
I just do. I mean, you go back to the Monmouth race. That wasn't a graded race, but she ran a good number that day, running 3rd. I just think this works out for her this afternoon. But
okay,
we'll see how it goes. 72 right on the line. That is the Allaire DuPont grade 3, race 8. One more. The 9th race for Phillies and Mares, 3 and up. Claiming price, $5,000. The wide open nickel. And, Keith, you have the 4, Majestic pick. Why not make the rider Javion Toledo first off the claim for Ferry?
Yeah, that's all I needed to hear.
That's all you
right?
needed to
hear. First off the claim, a big race, 3 races back, wins going away, 5.5, a closing effort. 6.5, I think, is going to be just fine. I know she hasn't won at the distance, but I think you're going to see maybe a little bit more positional speed. There's not a lot of true speed in the nightcap. Swirly Shirley's the type, you know, that gets the bug maybe today. She needs to break a little bit better, but
yep,
she could find herself up close along with Marie from Paris. But I like Majestic pick to make a run from mid-pack off claim. And I think Peshin last back to a sprint. I like her. 6.5 just might be the perfect distance for her. She finds herself sometimes with a lot to make up around the turn. But
yeah,
she's been consistent of late. Yeah. She's going to make that run.
I originally had Patient Last on top my first go around, and then I got looking at it, and I just noticed Swirly Shirley didn't get away well
right
at all last time. She likes to be well positioned early. She never had the opportunity to be there where she wants to be in that last race. So that's where I ended up on her. Sharp work, 36-3 since that last race. 4.9 for Keith in the nightcap, 3.4. For myself, a big day, 8 stakes this afternoon, all $100,000 stakes, plus the Allaire DuPont Grade 3, $150,000 race. Keith, the racing office couldn't have put together a much better card for return to racing here the day after Christmas.
Man, this is a treat for us. You know, I got this card a while back. You know, I think we drew it last Saturday and had a lot of time to look at it. And really, you know, they did a phenomenal job. Good quality all the way around. And this is fun. You know, you've got the 2-year-olds that are showing a lot of talent, trying to project what they're going to do down the line. And then you got your hardy vets that just bring it every time they run. The Cord Makers, the Harper's First Rise, the Lakai Taco Spring, where she told me to go. Yeah. So, I mean, this is one when you're looking at it as just a true racing fan. You love it. You know, you got to respect what these horses have brought to the table.
You absolutely do. That's going to do it for Keith and myself. Stand by. Dave Rodman will be up next with Scratches and Changes.
Good luck.